Decisions reached at the ICAO Assembly, that's a reference to the fact that subsequent to the Assembly, the European Union has announced plans to extend the EU ETS to, on an airspace basis to include foreign airlines, but without the consent of their respective governments, and we've taken exception to that and made some comments against that. We've called on all governments to respect the decisions reached at the ICAO Assembly, and to build on the agreed consensus by working together to build a global MBM scheme for adoption in 2016 and implementation in 2020. A global MBM needs to be implemented in a way that's fair and equitable, avoids any competitive market distortion, and which reconciles the differing interests and perspectives of developed and developing nations. I'll just run through the resolutions and I'll take Q&A at the end. On air cargo security, I talked about the commercial challenges, but in terms of the resolution, we're just focusing on air cargo security. The air cargo supply chain is extremely secure. That's one of the reasons people use air cargo, is because it's fast and safe and secure. High-value goods go by air, time-sensitive goods go by air. So by its nature, air cargo supply chains are extremely secure. But governments are still stepping up their requirements in terms of air cargo security. We've had two significant developments, ACAS by the US government and ACC3 by the EU, which comes into effect next year. And we've made some comments about not opposing those, but recognizing the burden it places on international airlines and the dangers of having a succession of national measures. What we've proposed is more mutual recognition of respective security regimes and cautioned against the idea of extraterritorial reach and having to do countless audits to satisfy multiple foreign governments. But I do stress that, as I said this morning, that effective security is the result of a good partnership between the industry and governments. And we remain committed to working with governments to keep air cargo flying as securely as it does. On aviation infrastructure, this ties into the growth projections we've talked about. We've passed a resolution, which in this case, by referring to infrastructure, is focusing on air traffic management. We've called on governments to keep make sure that ATM capacity keeps pace with commercial air traffic growth, and working with the military authorities where necessary to alleviate airspace usage limitations and constraints. This is a common issue around the world, although it's administered and managed in different ways. The tension or the coordination between military use and civil use is a worldwide issue. It's a particular issue in China because the way it's organized in China is the military responsible for all the airspace, including that which is allocated to civilian use. But as I said yesterday, the demand for civil aerospace usage keeps going up by massively in China, and that means it's always pushing against the limits of whether more space can be made available by the military. And that's particularly evident when you get other factors at play, like bad weather causing other difficulties in terms of congestion, routing of traffic. We've also called on governments to Asian governments to commit to a program of investments in efficient air traffic management, prompt implementation of recognized international standards and procedures, and best operational practices. This is all for the common good, and it needs to be planned well ahead of time, given the growth trajectory we talked about. On passenger facilitation, we have extremes. There are occasions where you can get through immigration, particularly coming home to your own country, within a matter of seconds using electronic gates. So this is the payoff from e-passports and identity cards equivalents with chips. But even when you have e-passports, there are other cases where you can spend 2 hours waiting to get through border processing procedures. So clearly, we're not getting the payoff from automation, the fact that we provide advanced information about passengers to governments as mandated by them. That should translate into speedier processing once you get to land at the airport and are processed through immigration, but that doesn't always happen. So We've asked governments to strike a better balance between national border control objectives and the need for efficient passenger facilitation, for governments to use electronic data interchange systems using common data standards in order to maximize efficiency levels in the processing of not just passengers but also crew, and indeed there's a read across to cargo, similar opportunities to speed up the flow of cargo. On passenger rights, 60 governments and counting have already implemented or proposing to introduce rules governing the treatment of passengers in a variety of circumstances. There are a couple of holdouts. Singapore and Australia have both, in different ways, taken a principled stance that it's inappropriate to have aviation-specific consumer rights legislation. But in many other countries, we're seeing prescriptive legislation. There are two problems. One is inconsistency. Makes it very difficult for airlines to apply any sort of uniform policy, and that's already led to a lot of confusion for passengers as to what they can expect and what are their entitlements under the different regimes. So it's a highly unsatisfactory situation. It's been the subject of much discussion this year in two major ICAO meetings. As a consequence of that, industry, of which AAPA is a part, has injected proposals to work around some standard principles, and those are attached. Principles have been published as an annex, and we think that's a good working start to agree on some basic principles, but there is still this wider question of to what extent should governments be regulating details such as cancellations, refund policies, booking practices, and so on and so forth. In general, we favor market solutions. Give consumers choice, let airlines compete, let producers compete, and then rely on the marketplace to provide the right answers. The truth is nobody knows what the answers are. We were discussing this morning how passenger expectations and demands have changed dramatically over the last 10 years. Product offerings that would have been thought unsatisfactory 10 years ago now seem to be extremely popular. So base fares and so on and so forth. So, you know, base fares, very restrictive refund policies, you could have said, well, those are unattractive. It turns out those are, you know, amongst the most popular fare classes in particular markets, that they just want the best fare and are prepared to contemplate paying more for other things. So this, by the same token, trying to guess what people want in the way of baggage allowances or refund flexibility or rerouting flexibility and so on and so forth, I think the market is probably a better place to find the multiple solutions that satisfy the needs of a very diverse travelling public. And lastly, I've already mentioned, but taxation. Taxes and charges, disguised as charges, represent about 15% of your ticket prices in US and Europe. It's hard to pin down what an average figure is for Asia. I hope it's a bit lower than that, but we face continuing demands to add additional taxes, and one of our problems as an industry is that we are very efficient at administration and handling cash. So when you buy your ticket, you'll find all sorts of listings of this, that, and the other charge or tax that may be buried inside the ticket price. In some countries, the government is mandating that we conceal it. The US is one of those. One of the discussions is the extent to which you should be able to say to the passenger, here's the breakdown, please understand that many of these charges are government-imposed charges or taxes. But even in our region, we have some taxes in place and some sort of proposals to introduce taxes. Two of the most recent ones are two countries in Asia have thought about imposing charges on visitors, international visitors, to fund the medical expenses of uninsured international visitors. We think that's a bad, a poorly conceived idea, and we don't think it'll achieve its objectives. And our fear is these things, once they appear, they tend to take on a life of their own and persist long after the purpose is forgotten. So we remind governments that aviation generates growth and jobs. It's a catalyst for economic growth across the wider economy. and taxing travel and taxing mobility has hidden adverse consequences for the rest of the economy and the competitiveness of the countries. Some countries get that. Some countries have learned that the hard way by imposing taxes and then withdrawing them. Happened in Netherlands, happened in Ireland. So there are some case studies where people said, you know what, this isn't a good idea, and they rolled them back. It would be better if they hadn't been imposed in the first place. So that's it, roundup of this year's resolution. Some of them are repeating previous resolutions on similar subjects, but with some different angles. But those represented what the member airline delegations felt collectively were high-level issues that needed to be addressed, and where regulators could do a better job, particularly working with industry, to address these challenges. With that, I'll open it up to questions, please. On any subject you like, aviation related preferably.
Just a quick factual check. The two Asian countries that imposed visitor charges to pay for uninsured visitors, which were they?
I think they're talking about it. The two I have in mind are Thailand and Indonesia.
They're talking about it?
Yes. That's why we're talking about it as well. Now's the time to get the points across. But there have been many others in the past.
On that subject, did you chat to your colleagues at Thai about whether they've had discussions with the government about the planned taxes?
I've not, because Dr. Soriak sent his apologies and wasn't able to join us. Bangkok Airways were with us, and they're concerned. I mean, they share our concern. And they're in the hospital, but one of their side business, their major business, their parent company, is in the hospital business in a big way. But I didn't mention that.
Yeah, thank you.
I hadn't thought of that at the time, but maybe they wouldn't mind more medical treatment for business. No, it's just a bad principle. We've had this in the past, levies for health, malaria programs, or solidarity taxes, Chirac, from Monsieur Chirac, and so on. And there are many others. But I think we're trying to get across the basic principle. It's very easy to think, well, they won't notice it. It's just a small tax. But overall, aviation bears a pretty heavy tax burden. The tax isn't on our profits. They're not that dumb. If the tax was on the profits, they wouldn't make much. The taxes are always on the tickets, right? They're always straight off the top line, the revenue. So. Yes.
Yesterday we talked a little bit about the low-cost carriers and the lack of members within AAPA. Could you give us an indication, please, of the costs of becoming a member so that we can understand a little bit better as to maybe why they're delaying their membership?
Yeah, we run a pretty tight operation. The membership costs are really to run the secretariat, and those are shared amongst the members in accordance with a formula which is partly based on equal shares and partly based on a size dependent in terms of traffic within the region. So it ranges, but we're talking tops a few $100,000 a year per airline. Now that's equivalent of how many full-time employees. That's one way you might think about it. The other thing you have to bear in mind, there's a cost of participation as far as time, effort, and attention, as I stressed this morning. The organization is successful not just because of the efforts of the secretariat, but because of the efforts put in by the member airlines in attending meetings, working in task forces, developing positions, joint lobbying. Many of the meetings we attend were accompanied by representative member airlines. So you've got to weigh that as well. On the flip side, you get the benefits of what we do because we're working for the airline community as a whole. You could say, well, you get the benefits, you get free ride. So there's a need for some degree of peer pressure as far as we all agree it's a good thing, so let's share in the cost. So that's really the way it is. So now you could take a different view of saying, well, we'll act as a members organization and we'll deliver benefits to members exclusively, but we've not taken that approach because we've always taken a broad-minded view. As for representing the interests, and we have plenty of carriers with low-cost operations, and as someone said on the panel today, all of us have low-cost operations, all of us are managing costs, You have low-cost marketing strategies, low-cost pricing strategies. Everyone's doing that. So there's no particular distinction. We certainly welcome participation, as we do, and we'd certainly welcome applications for membership. But there is a cost, it has to be said. There's one over here. One at the back.
On the problem of taxes and charges, maybe you could do more to get the message across to the traveller that 15% or more of the ticket isn't going to the airline. And I could make the suggestion also that because on the same part of the ticket you're putting the line for fuel surcharges, which the traveller naturally sees as something going to the airline, you're sort of confusing your message. If you wanted to say this chunk isn't ours, you'd put it in bigger type or something like that.
Yeah, I agree with that. There are occasions where you've got a limited number of data fields and certain things get lumped together. I agree that when government taxes get lumped along with fuel surcharges and the like, which I agree it's confusing. There needs to be clarity as to when you talk about these taxes and charges, government taxes and charges, what those amount to. That's why I said the analysis is clearer in the States because you've got one US government and they have a lot of them and you can itemize them and actually show. That's why I got the 15% figure. And our counterparts, A4A in America, do run full page adverts in the newspapers. I don't know how they can afford it, but anyway they do, printouts of like a receipt from a little printer saying, you know, here's what your bill was made up of today, just to highlight it. And so one of the subjects of discussion has been in the States has been the extent to which airlines should be told, no, you're meant to just bury it inside the ticket price. You shouldn't be treating it as an add-on. And similarly in Europe insists that the passenger has to know the full fare before he hits the buy button, which is fair enough. Because there was some of the low-cost carriers in Europe were advertising the fares and then adding on the government taxes and charges after you hit the credit card button on the basis of they thought it wasn't. They weren't selling those services, they were just collecting money for the government, but the government soon put them right. So you now have to include all of that.
Couple of questions. Regarding what is the average yields of what is the average yield of your members? And when do you expect to perhaps announce the new member from the South Asia or China segment? And next year, what will be your major focus? Because there's so many issues.
Sorry, first one?
The yields.
Yeah, I don't have them to hand. We'll get back to you on that. We do publish a statistical report annually, and that tracks aggregated yields, first business economy. So on a RPK, revenue passenger kilometer basis. So that information's available. As far as South Asia, I mean, the GMT 527, now that we're open to, it widened the definition, we're certainly open to any interest in applications, and we'll be pursuing that as an opportunity. I don't have a timetable. And on the priorities, it would be great if we could set the priorities, but the legislative agenda is set by others, it's set by the political process. So some things move at a certain pace, some things come and go, some things get bogged down in the legislative process, some things disappear, and then some things just blow up unexpectedly. So we have to respond. So part of the problem is, it's the old Charlie Chaplin thing of spinning the plates. It's not elegant. You're trying to keep the plates spinning and you really just have to think, well, what are the ones we're going to focus on? So this year, whether we liked it or not, there was a huge focus on environment, as was clear from all the discussions you've heard. That wasn't a personal session, that was the way the agenda was going. Lots of other good stuff was done at the ICAO assembly, but it was non-contentious. The security stuff had gone through a high-level security meeting, the safety stuff had gone through numerous high-level safety meetings. The assembly simply endorsed and approved those, and massive amounts of work. There were 400 and something working papers at the assembly. So massive amounts of work gets done, not very controversially, and then certain issues become hot topics. So environment was one of those. Infrastructure is really coming up fast because we don't have the luxury of waiting to see if the growth eventuates. It's clear that regardless of the the details, we face some significant challenges in stepping up infrastructure capacity. So that's another focus. Now, as I say, we're on the receiving end. If new legislation appears, we have to be ready to respond. Sometimes you get when you get close to the regulators, you get to get a sense of what might be next and what they might be thinking. In fact, you're better off trying to shape policy before they've crafted it than arguing they've done it wrongly. So, we shall see. Remember, the US, and I mentioned, emphasized the fact that Washington and Brussels, they respond to their constituents, which are their domestic constituencies in America and in Europe. So they're responding to a political process. So partly from the regulatory side and partly from market-driven commercial challenges.
Yes, I'm Brendan with the CABA Center for Aviation. A couple questions. First one on the budget LCC question.
Yeah.
Have you guys considered at all trying a kind of scheme to bring in the LCC subsidiaries? You got seven of your members with LCC subsidiaries. That's almost half. Now, if you look at the global alliances, they're looking at some of them are looking at schemes to bring in LCCs that is kind of a lower cost way. So perhaps there's a way to get some of those LCC subsidiaries in, because they're not going to want to pay a whole second set of membership fees.
No, absolutely. I mean, but we view those subsidiaries and associates as de facto members anyway, and they're able to attend meetings, and their parent companies share information. But you're right, in terms of, we have thought about that, in terms of the additional incremental cost would be very modest. But you wouldn't expect them to pay on the individual share.
But if you get them on the letterhead, then maybe you can track more of the independent LCCs, right?
That's a good idea. Maybe I should show a lot more logos on the list of members.
Or a couple of triple counters.
They're proliferating, yeah.
And you have the regional subsidiaries too, like the Thai Smiles and the Silk Air. So.
Yeah, I mean, it's a good idea. I'll put them on the slide. No, seriously, we have many of those carriers attending meetings, particularly on safety and security, where they're pretty lean operations, most of those LCC subsidiaries and associates, like their purebred LCC standalone LCCs. But they have a keen interest in sharing information, particularly on technical issues, safety, security, less so on environment if they're just focused within the region at the moment.
Yeah, but if you say you represent X number of million passengers in the budget segment, it would add voice, and it would perhaps persuade the whole sector. Because there's no LCC representation in this region. There is a bit in Europe, but there's nothing around here. So,
yeah.
And the other question on geography, I know the South Asia question was asked about in China. What is the geographic limit of AAPA right now? Has it been extended so that it is open to?
Yeah, it's 5 to 12. We used to be 7 to 12, but during the year we changed it to 5 to 12. GMT plus 5 to GMT plus 12.
Based on time zones?
Yes.
Andrew, sorry.
For example, Myanmar falls outside our old definition. So our new definition includes India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, all the way across to there.
Central Asia.
Depends on the way the dateline, not the dateline, the time zone lines go.
That was my question. How much of Central Asia is now brought into the potential catchment or?
To be honest, I'd have to have a look. I mean, we wanted to align our definition of Asia Pacific to be closer to the ICAO definition of Asia Pacific. But ICAO goes through the stands and puts some in one category and some in the other. Although most people haven't woken up to the fact that some of those people are classified as Europe by ICAO, and others are classified as Asia Pacific.
Andrew, would you say that the order that you've given the resolutions here was the order of importance to members, or if not, could you list perhaps what the top three are?
No, I mean, I think when we were talking about them, we grouped them by functional area, and so I wouldn't read too much into that.
So therefore, therefore from that group, would you say, could you pick two that were of most importance to the members this year?
No, they're all important. Otherwise, we wouldn't have spent time crafting the words and making the statement and making sure we had solidarity amongst the members. And we had lots of other ideas which were left on the cutting room floor long before we got to the meeting here, but they were subject to discussion amongst the members during the committees and working groups before this assembly. By the time it gets to the assembly, it's got to pass the test. Do we care about it? Is it important enough? Are we coherent about what we want to say? Do we have any differing views amongst ourselves, and so on? So
this was to be put together sort of this afternoon, and it's a bit of a record, isn't it? There was some of this prepared before the. It's you know, it's quite intricately worded. It's,
yeah, I apologise for that. I mean, you should try the original resolutions, which are even more intricately worded. But
no, right, I mean, you get it done this there. Afternoon.
No, no, this is because the draft resolutions were circulated to member airlines 10 days ago, and today we had some discussion, and we had one or two minor wording changes. That, you know, the odd word here and there, and a bit of strengthening this or reducing that. And on occasions in the past, to be honest, we have had resolutions that weren't approved, and so we didn't publicise them. In fact, we didn't have a good one. So. One or two more? Michael, I'll go back.
I've got plenty more, but it would be a bit selfish. Under environment, was there any discussion of biofuels? And if not, could you say where the association is with the discussion of that issue?
Yeah, we spend all our time talking about MBMs as if there's nothing else. You've got to remember, the industry's had a three-target strategy of fuel efficiency improvements of 1.5% per annum, carbon neutral growth in 2020, and a 50% reduction in net emissions by 2050 compared to 2005. Those are targets, and then we have a four-pillar strategy of technology, operations, infrastructure, and supplementary market-based measures, and included in that technology is biofuels, alternative fuels. We've done a lot of work on biofuels. There's a lot of activity going on. Biofuels have powered well over 1,000 flights in the industry. Biofuels for aviation have to be drop-in fuels. They're not made from crude oil, they're made from other feedstocks, but they have to be jet kerosene certified as essentially equivalent to kerosene. They have to meet all the technical standards to be certified as jet fuel, blended with jet fuel, and perform exactly like jet fuel. So the good news is those technical hurdles have been overcome, and a variety of feedstocks have been used. The challenges of biofuels right now are feedstock prices are high, there are no economies of scale in the production of biofuels because the volumes are tiny, and so it's very hard to compete with conventional jet in terms of cost. We're nowhere near. So all of the test flights you've heard about are being conducted with very small quantities of alternative fuels, which frankly cost multiples of conventional jet fuel, 2, 3, 5 or more times more costly. So the big challenge is, how do we get from technical feasibility to economic commercial competitiveness? And that involves industry. The manufacturers are closely involved, Boeing, Airbus, Embraer and others. Bombardier, and it involves working with the fuel suppliers, the biorefiners, and the feedstocks. The feedstocks are farmers, so the agriculture and the economics of feedstocks is the critical issue. If the feedstocks are so expensive, there's no way you can get to an end-use jet price that's competitive with conventional jet. So that's where we are. We had an interesting, useful conference in Bangkok. Couple of months ago, Martin?
In September.
September, Southeast Asia Fuel User Group, Boeing, Airbus, ourselves. We had 100 people? 100?
100 people, just over 100.
100 people. So these are some of the topics that were discussed there. And those activities are echoed around the world in different regions. So it's not for want of trying. The challenges are commercialization and scale. But it's extraordinary that 5 years ago you'd have said odds against getting alternative fuels certified for use on commercial flights. But in fact, there have been a lot of commercial flights. But if you ask why there aren't more, it's because there are insufficient quantities available at competitive prices. There's a limit to how many demonstrator flights you want to do using expensive fuel. just to prove the point. But for, if you talk to the producers and they say, well, how do we get from here to there? It's the, in America, they call it the valley of death. You know, how do you get from here across this, across the valley of death, the other side? How do you get to competitive levels? If you know the answer, you can get rich.
One question regarding going back to cargo. Unlike attending an IATA event, the one word that you hear very often at IATA, and I've hardly heard anything of it here, is e-freight. Has there been any sort of discussion amongst the membership on that particular topic, which for IATA is a very burning topic?
There hasn't here. There is a regulatory dimension to that, but basically that's an industry project which needs other stakeholder involvement. Several of our member airlines are involved in those activities within IATA, are trying to push that forward. So, you know, we're supportive, but it wasn't the subject of discussion here. It's disappointing that the penetration and adoption has been as slow as it has, and there is a government dimension to that. But on the other hand, in Asia, you've got some of the best cargo operators, you've got some of the best cargo terminal operators, you've got some of the most enlightened governments. So some of the most effective pilots in the e-freight have been in this part of the world. So Asian airlines are engaged in that and supporting the IATA program.
Sorry, if I can just add on, do you know how many of your members are not the countries that they're domiciled in? Are not signatories to the Montreal Convention? Because you brought up the regulatory issue, so that's basically the key part of it.
Any idea?
I believe that Vietnam's not party to it, and also from what I understand, Thailand is in the process of ratifying it. They're not in it yet, but it's going through the legislative process. So most of the other countries are quite supportive, and the only reason for the time that it's taken for them to accede to the Montreal Convention is mostly because of their own legislative and ratification legal processes.
There are other countries, but those are the main ones. Thailand's the one where I understand is imminent. That'll be very welcome.
Do you want to make this the last question, or do you want a couple more?
Well,
if there are a couple more.
Peter.
Sir, I'm just wondering what your members feel about the pilot shortage. We hear some people tend to dismiss it, and others say that they're just in the wrong spot. Is there any concern with your airline presidents that they will have a problem in the future with pilots and technicians, engineers, ground engineers?
Well, Boeing have got some figures on how many professionals will be needed across the world, including regional breakdowns, and they have a figure for pilots. From memory, it's 191,000 over the next whatever decade or two or whatever. So you can look that up. And ICAO have some manpower forecasting estimates.
It wasn't the number so much, it's just is it viewed as a concern by your executive airline people?
Yes, because when you look at growth, finding skilled manpower and keeping skilled manpower, my experience as CEOs are more concerned about the cost of manpower and the cost of losing manpower and training, retraining and so on. So when you know, shortage of pilots is usually code for I don't like the cost of hiring new pilots or what I've got to pay my existing pilots. Because when there's a scarcity, you get more job turnover, poaching, and that pushes up costs and narrows the difference between the lower cost areas and higher cost areas, because otherwise people move. So you see the impact on cost structures and causing some disruption to pay scales and comparability across different regions. And the LCCs, who have been expanding very rapidly, have obviously been trying to recruit pilots from whatever source they can find. But to the bigger question of is there going to be a shortage of pilots, I'm a believer in market forces. So my experience is if pilot training is open as an activity, is open to private sector involvement, the overall aggregate of privately funded pilot training schools aren't going to miss the opportunity to meet that need. You know, 20 years ago in China, where there was one pilot training school run by the government, CAC, and they decided in their annual budget how many pilots they'd train, and a year later they might have not trained enough, then you might get a mismatch. But in a world where you can have private sector training, I don't think I'm not too concerned about a long term. But in the short term, you get a surge in demand somewhere, draws pilots, and that takes. So yes, in the lower cost region you are, the more you face poaching and upward pressure. And so pilot salaries, so the dispersion in pilot salaries is narrowing around the world. There are some restrictions. Chinese pilots are not able to leave China and in search of their fortunes elsewhere. But many other countries, pilots move around. That's leveling up, if you like. Pilot salaries in India doubled during one of the surges, even as all the airlines were losing money in large quantities. So that's an example of the leveling up. But by the same token, this is a competitive business, so that, by the same token, puts pressure on rewarding the people who can deliver the most cost-effective solution. So, as well as pilots, as Pakamir said this morning, technicians, don't underestimate engineers and technicians. Some of the training timescales are longer for those than they are for, particularly for senior licensed engineers, longer than for pilots. And you need a lot of those, despite the efficiency and reliability of modern aircraft and engines. Okay, one more, if there is, otherwise. Yeah, okay, one more. Last one.
Thank you.
Just on the subject of aviation infrastructure, I know we mentioned a bit about Indonesia and their headaches before. China's just started, loosening regulations on low-cost carriers, and a lot more airlines seem to be coming into the market. Do you foresee a big situation in the next 12 months where we might get a big crunch in terms of aviation infrastructure and capacity in China?
We're already there.
Yeah.
In terms of airspace and slots at the major airports, we're already at the limit. The congestion, the on-time performance is deteriorating in a chronic way, and essentially you're slot constrained at the major airports. So having more entrants, it doesn't matter what you call them, more aircraft is more aircraft, so it doesn't matter whether they're labeled LCCs or they're just the majors adding more capacity. So it's a challenge regardless. But I was at the low-cost carrier conference that John Bailey referred to in Beijing last week, and that was one of the topics. That it's no good freeing up the market and allowing new airlines to get started if they face constraints of can't buy aircraft, can't find pilots, can't find slots at major airports. But don't worry, it'll be fine. As Robert Martin might say, you might look twice at the business plan and the funding and so on. So I don't link the two. Chinese traffic has grown. The LCC penetration in China is very low. You've only got Spring, really. Unless you think the Chinese carriers are low cost, which by some arguments they are. But the market's grown stupendously. We have the problems regardless. Now, Indonesia is a case in point where you've had a huge growth of stimulation of traffic and new capacity coming in, and then you've got major problems. So yeah, that highlights it. But we all face this. This is an area where, regardless of your business model, we have common interests. Safety and infrastructure capacity are. On the panel in Beijing, we had Azran from AeroShareX. So that's one thing we're fully in agreement on in terms of infrastructure challenges.
Mm. In China, they are obviously building a lot of new airports and expanding the existing ones. But do you see the crunch to be something that's going to go on for a few years?
Airspace is the issue. They have a plan to improve flow control, introduce the latest technologies, some of the acronyms we've included in the infrastructure resolution, or an indirect reference, not specific to China, but they're well aware of those techniques, but their plan to get them introduced and coordinate the different parties, we think it could be accelerated, and in some ways needs to be accelerated. In other areas, again, there's an awareness in Indonesia, as Pakimir was saying. AJ was talking about Malaysia when we were talking privately, and getting budgets approved to upgrade the, and so on and so forth. And having talked about pilots and engineers, air traffic controllers are sometimes scarce. even though we're seeing increasing amounts of automation, it's still quite a labor-intensive activity. Unlike cockpits are being automated, so you've gone from multi-pilots to fewer, down to two, and a lot more automation, but we haven't seen that payoff. In the air traffic management hasn't really changed much. Instead of having strips of paper, we now have little strips of paper on the screen electronically. But the controller's role, you know, the big shift would be to go to automated satellite-based, where the aircraft navigates and the controller just monitors. At the moment, the controller tells the aircraft where he's allowed to fly and where to fly. But it's like, it'd be quite hard to shift over to an automated scheme because everything's running. So that's the challenge. You can't change the scheme piecemeal.
Do you think that would there be a public sort of backlash against something like that as well, taking the safety aspect away from human control?
I think people trust flying as extraordinarily safe, as I said this morning. The fact they don't know how it's done doesn't worry them. It's extraordinary. People can't understand how metal objects can fly, and when you look at an air traffic controller's job of little dots moving on the map and the density of traffic, I don't know if you've seen some of these computer animations in real time, you get it on your iPhone. Was it flight radar? You can get a real time ADS-B track on any flight.
So our last question became three. So
I'm sorry. Well, thank you very much for your time. I really appreciate your participation.